Shabbat Shalom to all of you.
Shabbat Shalom.
We have arrived to a very important portion in the Parashat, in the Shemot HaSefer, in the book of Exodus. And this is a very important part because here, in certain way, interestingly enough, as our sages tell us, part of this portion has been enveloped, it has been covered by the Ohel Moed, or the Ten of Meetings, and in a beautiful way, because it is the sin of the Golden Calf. Eger Masachet, the Eger Masachet is the Golden Calf that was made by the people of Israel, and that was the awful sin of Israel just coming out of Egypt. Here I want to be able to explain to you certain things that I have been dealing and delving for a long time through the years. You know, I have studied theology as something, as a science of the certain religion that they try to interpret and explain God. Something that is almost impossible. And only we can know about him through his revelation and through his actions, through how he works. But we human beings, we have put ourselves, and we are constantly putting ourselves in, trying to put ourselves in the top of the mountain. And we trying to build our own sigurats, you know, and to be like the Creator. And that is a futile enterprise that we keep going and doing over and over again. But let me tell you something that is important in this conjecture that I am trying to develop this morning. We have heard many ideas about the redemption of men, the forgiveness of their sins, and all these different things that in the theology of men, they try to explain how our Creator acts and reacts and works with men. It is obvious that we know that we have a loving and merciful God. And in this portion, we see the 13 midot, you know, the Shalosh Israel midot, the 13, these 13 principles that of the mercy of God, to try to understand how wonderful God is and how we act with men. But one thing that brought to my attention is how we as human beings, we are constantly trying to protect something that we think is sacred instead to look at what the scripture tells us. For example, in this portion, there is a very large portion that is talking, first of all, I call it the envelope proportion because the middle, chapter 32, 34, are covering by the Ohel Moed or the Ten of Meetings, you know, prior to getting to chapter 32 and the disobedience of Israel, we see all the instructions about how to make the Ten of Meetings and what are the appliances and the furniture and the and how to do it. And even at the end, going to, in chapter 30, we're going to tell us, and 31, we're going to tell us about that our Creator is going to choose two men, very special men, Bezalel and Oholiab, are from the tribe of Judah and from the tribe of Dan. And even there, we receive a simple message. He chose the tribes of the tribe, Judah, and he chose Dan, the tribe, the lower tribe in the view of the 12th tribe. And then what he's trying to tell us that he's choosing all Israel. Now there are beautiful pictures here that from time to time we are going to see if we are not literalists and we look about the message that convey the scripture. But after that comes the sin of the golden calf. this sin marked Israel forever and has been a very hard thing to swallow for our dear rabbis and sages. Because there is a certain way a nostalgia that, and we're trying to defend our forefathers and the people who left Egypt, and we try to cover them with a lot of things that they really were not. You know, the truth of the matter is that when our Creator took out Israel from Egypt, the Israel as a people were in the lowest of the lowest of the lowest point in their life, but more than in their life as a life material way that we see it, they were in the lowest of the lowest in their spiritual life and the holistic thing. They have already lost all hopes. They have already even lost the idea about who was the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Very few they had an idea about it. And they were almost inclined to follow the gods of Egypt, or were already saturated by the gods of Egypt. In other words, they had become idolaters or pagans, whatever we want, a label we want to put it. And this is the problem about religion. In religion, we're trying to sanitize the word of our Creator. We're trying to make it look better for our heroes and for our people. You know, there is no more honest book than the Torah, a writing, that tells us about all our heroes of the faith, and each one of them are pictured as men with their own failures, not trying to sanitize them, not trying to make them better or greater than anybody else, but totally the contrary. They're trying to show us men. But the religious people had a tendency to overstate the idealization of these heroes, to make them greater than anything else, and doing that, believe me or not, they take their humanity, and they take away what made them great. Because in spite of being human beings, they overcome many situations. This is the same idea about the Mashiach. The real Mashiach as a man, you know, an envoy, a messenger of the Creator. And the religion has made him greater than life. To the point that when you see the Mashiach that certain religion has made, has nothing to do with the Mashiach or the scriptures, because they have made them too big. Not only so big that they have made even equal to our Creator and greater than the Creator. You know, that is of course idolatry and paganism in a structure and basis. The scripture, the Torah, very clear say that our Creator is not a man. That's very clear, simple. And when we as humans, we want to humanize our Creator, we diminish Him. And when we trying to idealize and divinize men, we destroy men. I wonder if you see these two perspectives, two extremes, because that's how religion is made up. Another thing that's very important in this chapter, I want to do to look peripheral instead to be puntilla. One thing that is important that you see here in this structure, that you are going to see a man called Moshe Rabbeinu, our teacher Moses, and you're going to see the people of Israel struggling as humans with all their shortcomings, with all the limitations, and in spite of that, we are going to see the greatness of our Creator and His mercy to us. This is what we need to see. In this portion, I'm going to go to chapter 32, because this is the part that I want to deal 32 and 33, basically. And maybe go to 34 about the midot. That it's important that we see in this portion, you know, the attributes of God. The Shalosh Esrei Midot, that is called in chapter 34, verses 6 and 7, and maybe I want to be ending with that portion. I don't know if I'm going to have the time, but let's go. In chapter 32, we're going to have a change of the narrative, and basically, it's our Creator who is going to start the dialogue with Moshe Rabbeinu. And then, here is going to explain that, first of all, that the people of Israel saw that Moshe Rabbeinu was not coming back from the mountain. And they saw that, or he's dead, or he's lost, but something happened, and we need to replace him. Now, and the people, the lady, said to him, look at how the people say, okay? Now when the people saw that Moshe delayed coming down from the mountain, the people gathered together to Aaron and said to him, come, make us gods that shall go before us. For as for this Moses, the man who brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we do not know what has become of him. What is interesting, if you look at this narrative, basically the people of Israel are looking and seeing that Moshe Rabbeinu was the man. And here, when I say the man, okay, the man, now what I'm saying is this is different to the rest of the people. This is something special. And I already make us a god to replace him. They already were in the process, in my understanding, making Moshe Rabbeinu like a god. Of course, there are wise, our sages, our rabbis, they're going to go totally different route. Okay, but I wonder you see what I say, the scripture, not what the comment. Those who comment the scripture, they tell you, because the worst thing that can happen is when you want to try to defend God. I always say to people, you know, I am not an apologist. I don't like apologetics, and I never have been involved with debates. I detest debates. You know why? Because in a debate, people can make you. They can say whatever they want to say and make the scripture to say whatever they want to say. And if they are very smart and they're very quick in their mind, they wit with their words, they can say things that sometimes can surprise you. And not that the scripture is saying that, but it looks like that that's what it's saying. You know, that you have you heard that that statement the theologian say, you know, any verse out of context is a mere pretext. Interestingly, they announce that over and over and over again, and that's what they do. You know, I have told you before that most of the people, they do eisegesis. You know, what is eisegesis? Pre-known ideas that I have about certain things, or pre-knowledge that I have done myself. You know, I'm introducing the scripture, and I make look like that the scripture is telling me that. You know, and instead that the scripture speak to me, I speak to the scriptures to tell me whatever they want to tell me. Okay, that is eisegesis. But exegesis is just the opposite. It's to let the scriptures speak for themselves, for itself. And this is why it's so important to look at the scriptures. And Aaron said to them, break off the golden earrings which are in the ears of your wives and your sons and your daughters, and bring them to me. So all the people broke off the golden earrings which were in their ears and brought them to Aaron. And he received the gold from their hand, and he fashioned it in engraving tools and made a molding calf, a Egel Asefa. Okay. First of all, only a curiosity. Men at that time wore earrings. I don't know where they were it, but they were it. Okay? And, because today it's very fashionable among men to wear here, and the nose, they put it here in the air. You know, I don't know. To me, I don't know how they do it, but they do it. You know? Whatever part you can imagine, they have put a ring there. No, well, at that time they had it. And then they say, you know, he made, and then I am in verse 4, okay? And I want to go from the Hebrew because it's important to look at the Hebrew, what it say, okay? Bayomeru, that they say, this is plural, okay? That's no Aaron who is saying, but the people is saying. Bayomeru, and they say, Bayomeru, Ele, Eloheja, Israel. Here are your gods, your God, Israel. Now I am reading verse 4 at the end. God, Eloheja. Okay? Your God. This is your God, O Israel, that brought you out of the land of Egypt. Look at that. Brought you out of the land of Egypt. First point. Look at every sage or midrash, and then you want to learn that they say that they never ever made a god. What they made was something to replace Moshe Rabbeinu. That is the first white, cold wash to clean the thing. Yeah, to, no, there is a term in English when you want to clean it.
White wash.
You know, that's it. Please, thank you. You need to help me with my English idiomatic expressions. Okay. Here, basically, they're trying to clean, you know? I call it the sanitizing. Very clear. These people have committed idolatry. And they have replaced the true God with the Egel Masachet, or the Egel Sahar, the golden calf. And one of the culprits, and the innocent guy, Mr. Aaron. You know? Sometimes people ask themselves, no, how our Creator, after all that Aaron did, he made him a Kohen Gadol. You see, this is even better for us to understand my point that I started this morning. The scriptures speak about our people straightforward, and doesn't make them better or greater than anybody else. We do not idealize our people. Our Creator is telling us that He is going to use regular people. I told you, the religious trying to idealize and made their human beings gods. I told you how they have made the Messiah, who is a man, they have made a God. And the Supreme God and His God greater than anybody else, and even greater than the God, who, the Creator. Depending how people see it. We have seen that. This is pure religion. And that religion is affecting all the religions in the world. Because each one of them, they're trying to give you to you their own rules and regulations, and they are going to tell you that they're better than the others. And what is here the level plane that I call it. And it's the idea that we need to look an excuse for humanity to get away with murder. You know, we are going to phantom a God. But this God is so merciful and so loving and so caring that he doesn't care about the sin of anybody. And he's going to whitewash the sins of men. You know, and not only he's going to whitewash the sins of men, but won't make any longer men responsible for the sins, but he is going to take the sins of the men. That's how religion teaches you. You know, God won't be so bad that he won't destroy humanity. God won't be capable to do this. God will, that's not God. Because God is merciful and pure love. You know, and then you can do whatever you want to do, destroy the world, and you're okay. God is going to forgive you. We have got to that point. Today, we are in a world that doesn't matter what you do according to your own way. And this is nothing new. At the end of the book of Judges, the Shoftim HaSefer, what he say? And everyone did according to their own understanding. There's nothing new. We are not innovating the world. We are not rediscovering the wheel. It's already there. Then come the dialogue. Then when they said, this is your God of Israel. So then Aaron saw and he built an altar. Not only he made the idol, but now he builds an altar. No? And before then, Aaron made a proclamation and said, tomorrow is a feast to the Lord. And then they rose early in the next day, offered burnt offerings and brought peace offerings, and the people sat down and drink and eat and rejoice. And in other words, you read this in the Hebrew language, but it's saying it has an orgy. We keep sanitizing the, you know? We keep sanitizing. We are afraid to see the truth. These people were terrible. What I'm going to this string to explain to you, because I want to show you the side of our Creator. I want to show you about Moshe Rabbeinu as a man and the people of Israel. Then, verse 7. And the Lord said to Moses, go, get down, for your people who you brought, this is the part that I love it, I mentioned this before, and I'm going to repeat it only for the sake of understanding. And he said, and the Lord said to Moses, go, get down, for you people who you brought out of Egypt, okay, out of the land, have corrupted themselves. And they have turned aside quickly out of the way which I command them. They have made themselves a molten calf, and worship it, and sacrifice to it. And I say, this is your God, O Israel, that brought you out of Egypt. And the Lord said to Moses, I have seen these people, and indeed, it is a stiff neck, or keshech orech, a stiff neck. You know? And he said, now therefore, let me alone, that my wrath, my burning hot against them, and I may consume them, and I will make you a new, I'm going to make you a great people. Don't worry, I want to destroy all of them. I want to bring you a good people. I want to tell you one thing. The creature has a, when they put the God talking, sometimes they say God has sense of humor, and God also talks in a way, what he wants is for you to react. I always say when people say, oh, God put me in a test. You know, God didn't put you in a test. What God is doing is he's helping you to grow up. Okay? And remember that. When you go through a hard situation, when you go through difficult times in your life, when you are going through a very hard time, it's not that the Creator put it in your test. believe me, you know, our Creator is helping you to grow, because maybe you have been stuck and you are not going anywhere anymore. And what He's doing is now giving you the motivation to move. I know certain people here in our community that they are very hard to move. And how they move? When somebody push them. You know, and they're constantly saying, don't push me, don't push me. It's my way, it's my way. And you know, our Creator needs to push you sometimes a little bit for you to move. I have certain people that I know that are slow. Woo! That kill me. You know, only to, if I follow them, I will never go anywhere. You know, they will be the rest of their life holding here their hands and looking what is going to happen. How many people think in that way? You know, they're waiting for somebody else to do it. You know, I only going to enjoy after. You know, and our Creator make you to be participant of His creation, not only to enjoy the creation, but to work in it. Work is not a bad word, by the way. Okay. Now, He said, you know, this is God in Israel, wrote you, I'll read you. Then, verse 11, this is a beautiful part. You saw in verse 7, look at what God said. You people who grew you grow out of Israel. Verse 11. Then Moses pleaded with the Lord, his God, and said, Lord, why does your wrath burn hot against your people? Okay, who you have brought out of the land of Egypt with a great power and with a great and mighty hand. You like the books I play, you know?
Yeah.
Which people is? Is God's people or Moses' people? Okay, I want to leave you, because here then come Moses, look like a speak before our Creator, and he gave a beautiful speech. You know, so convincing the speech that God said, you know, Moses, you're right. Thank you for making me understand. You know, I didn't see that. I don't know how that passed away from me. But you're right. You're totally right. You are so merciful, and I am so unmerciful. I repent. It's a comic, no? That's it when people are literalists. They say, well, you see, God repented. You need to see the real thing. You need to know God's qualities and things to know what He's doing is. He is again. Do you remember I say that the one that doesn't move, God is going to push? The one that doesn't do anything, God is going to give you supposedly a test or something to make them to wake up. They put a situation, a difficult situation in their life, you know, when everything is hunky-dory and you don't need to do anything, and suddenly a tragedy or a hard situation happened to your life and you don't know. And why the first thing that you say, oh God, why you allow that thing happen to me? This is the first thing that you do, no? Bring blame to God. And then after a while, you start learning that maybe this is what God has done it for a reason. And through that situation, you can work. I have suffered that situation in my own life, in my family. And I can tell you that every tragedy that has happened in my family, after the tragedy, something great has come out. But at the moment in the middle of the tragedy, I was not able to check my head. I needed to have a time to slow down and to assimilate, to see, to look. And then after a time, I saw what our Creator did. I saw after what the Creator did. Keep that statement, that phrase for later on that I am getting there. Then this part, I want to tell you, you know, it's very important, because here is, if we talk about, like the Gentiles, the theology of God in the Torah. Here, there is a lot of theology of the God of the Torah, but in the right way. Look at what he's saying. Then must plead to the Lord his God and say, you know, and the great power and we mighty have. What should the Egyptians do unto them? And then turn you from your fierce wrath and relent from this harm to your people. That is verse 12. And remember Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Moshe Rabbeinu is giving the speech. Like God doesn't remember his promise. He already took the reason that he has taken Israel out of Egypt is because of the promise. But supposedly he's getting old. You know? He got a moment of amnesia. And he forgot. God forgot. This is I want that you see what ridiculous will be if you think in that way. That's not what is happening, but that's what it looks like they say. And then he say, you know, and say to them, I will multiply you the same than at all. So the Lord relented from the harm, and he say that he would not do that to his people. And, you know, and here looks like that God is repenting. And Moses turning and went down from the mountain. Then, later on, this is part that you need to see about Moses. Moses said, how are you going to do with the poor people? They didn't mean it. They were nice. Please remember you promised to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and you know, be good with them. And the good Moshe, you know, and goes down with his tarot so happy to his people. And then he sees the orgy, and he sees this golden calf, and the one, and his big brother is there as a priest. Dude, see, what is going on? And boom, get upset, so upset, that he just, he's telling God, don't get mad. Why do you get mad? And look at Moshe Rabbeinu. He get worse than him. Now who laugh? Now, if he break the tablet that our creator himself made it. And he was ready to, now he was ready to kill everybody, and not only that, but he say, those ones who are with me and with the God creator, let's destroy those ones that are against the God the creator. And the Levites came and took their swords and they killed 3,000. You know, I want to tell you, you look at Gematria, you want to see 3,000 to me is an allegorical number. It's not exact 3,000, but what is the mean? 3 and 1,000. Number 3, but you already know about what represents. You know, and 1,000 is totality, you know, the wholeness, the fullness, the all the evil that was there was destroyed. But next, he goes back after he makes right and he trying to calm down. In verse 25 say, now when Moses saw that the people were unrestrained, for Aaron had not restrained them to their shame among their enemies. Poor Aaron, he couldn't. Then Moses stood in the entrance of the camp and said, whoever is with the Lord's sign, come to me. And all the sons of Levi gathered themselves and gathered, and he said to them, thus saith the Lord, the God of Israel, let every man put his sword against his hand. You have heard the same. The son of Levi, according to the word of Moses, and about 3,000, you know, 3,000, about, not exactly 3,000, 3,000 has a meaning, I already told you. Consecrate yourself today to the Lord, and he may bestow on you blessings of this day. Now it came to pass that the next day that Moses said to the people, you have committed a great sin. So now I will go up to the Lord. Perhaps I can make atonement for your sin. And then Moses returned to the Lord and he said, of these people have committed a great sin and have made for themselves a God of gold. You now, if you will, forgive their sins. But if not, I pray, blot me out of your book, which you have written. Look at, let me give you the whole picture here now before I go to the next answer from our Creator. Why a Creator allowed this to Moshe Rabbeinu, and how he revealed and informed it, and how it looked like that he's repenting and he's changing his mind to destroy the people of Israel. Until that moment, do you see the ping pong dialogue? Your people, the one that you took out of Egypt, that you took it out of the slavery, and now Moshe Rabbeinu answered him back in the same way, your people that you took out or you delivered from mighty hand. Okay. Looks like there is a ping pong game, no? But if our Creator is trying to see in Moshe Rabbeinu what is his sentiment, his relationship with the people of Israel. Until that moment, he keep telling he was stuck up. You know, I call it the reluctant leader. He was the one that I didn't want to be the leader of Israel. You pushed me. You know, I was very comfortable with giving my little animals, my bears and all of them. They were beautiful. You know, I was in my mountain, I was with my wife, my children, and I was playing there in the field. And then you say, go back. I would, all men, go back. That was too much for me. I need to face the Pharaoh. That was not. And the people of Israel didn't even want to listen to me. They didn't believe in me. You know, let's believe in you. You know, and you put me in a situation. And I was faithful. I obeyed you. But now, that's it, you people. And don't put it on me. They reject me. They didn't like me. That's all, you know, what are all those things? Suddenly, our Creator put Moses in a situation. And the situation, which is the situation? It is, you need to respond. Now is the time that you say, this is your people who will make you a new people. Because you are going to still be the leader. You cannot get out of that job. Okay? And suddenly, he wake up. And he identified with his people. You have heard me many times here in the community about the term to appropriate this place, to appropriate the community as Jews. How many times I have repeated over and over? The sad part is that many of us, we still do not understand that idea. A community is made by us, not by the guests. This community is made by each one of us that we are here, present, that we participate and we work together. Not by the outsiders. And nobody from outside is going to help us. We need to do it ourselves. Moshe Rabbeinu never appropriated the people. He was only following orders. He was doing only what our Creator taught him to do. He was only a messenger. Our Creator is saying to him, no, Moshe. You are part of these people. And you are going to be with the people and do with the people. And finally, he realized that his people. And when he sees that our Creator is not going to forgive them. And not to forgive them means to suffer the rest of their life. You know? He said, please, forgive them. And if you do not forgive them, please erase me from your book that you have written. He was willing. Look at the sacrifice of Moshe Rabbeinu for his people. He was willing to disappear for eternity. Because we have a hope, and we have something that the Torah teaches us about, that we are going to be eternal in the sense of that God gave us a neshama, a soul, and the soul is not destroyed. Only the one that can destroy the soul is our Creator. You know, we live eternal. And what he says is, erase me. Erase me from the book of life. The Hayim HaSefer. Hayim HaSefer. The book of life. Now, let's go to the theological part. That's a type we don't want to see. I'm going to give an answer from our Creator, not from the theologians. Okay? And this is important. Our Creator, not the theologians. And the Lord said to Moses, verse 33, chapter 32, verse 33. After Moses has asked God to forgive their sins or not, but to erase him from the book of life. Verse 33. This is important to understand it, okay? What I say, this is not a theological answer. This is God speaking to us, straightforward. And the Lord said to Moses, whoever has sinned against me, I will blow him out by my book. Of my book. Whosoever has sinned against me, I will blow out. He didn't say, I want to bring somebody else to pay for your sins. I want to bring an animal that he died and he paid for your sins. Don't worry. I want to make somebody else pay for your sins. You know? Don't worry. You are safe.
For life.
For life. Doesn't matter what you do, you are safe. The fact is, you see, you pay for it. No worse, no less. No more, no less. This is the reason that we need to understand about the compassion and the love of God. Most of the religions, what they do, they pass the buck, or the bucket, or the buck. They pass the buck. Well, you're a sinner. But you know what? I won't punish you. I want to punish somebody who's very dear to me. What a great love of God. And how many people have believed it? Don't worry, you have sinned. But I want to kill this animal to pay for your sin. They have taken everything out of context. Read Ezekiel 18. The person who sins is not the father, not the father going to pass the sin to the son, not the son to the father, not. Everybody who sins is responsible for the sin. The scripture teaches something, a very important thing. The Torah is given to us to have life and to have eternal life in the sense that we walk in the light. And the Torah teaches us, if we do something wrong, we have our Creator there, that we can come back to Him to do Shuvah, Teshuvah. To come back to Him, what we do, we confess our sin, we acknowledge what we have done wrong. That means that you can call it repentance, whatever you want, but repentance is not enough. You need to do your wrongdoing. What it means is you need to repay for what wrong have you done, and you are responsible for your acts. A sinful person, the only way that can reach forgiveness is through Teshuvah, the whole circle. That's what the Torah teaches. And our Creator is there to listen to us. This idea that God only help the good people and the people that are pure and holy, that is totally a made-up theology. If that was the case, he would never ever say Israel. Do you know that Israel never asked our Creator to take them out of Egypt? The only thing that they asked to our Creator was, please tell Pharaoh not to be too bad with us. We are content here. If it was for Israel, they will still in Egypt today. has given you the comparison and the parallel between Egypt and between the Shoah. Every time that Israel is too comfortable, every time that Israel is disappearing and is assimilating and is losing their understanding about the relationship with the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and when we are disappearing as a nation, we suffer that we are pushed. And don't push me, don't push me. But you need to wake up. We are wake up. Because we need to go back to the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Our God is merciful and has patience more than all of us together. Infinite. But get to the time. And he will never allow his people totally disappear. And then, more than then, we don't disappear. We constantly, we need to come back to him. What I mean to come back? Teshuva. To return to him. And then the Teshuva, then always it is. The idea that when our Creator, we say to him, we will do and we will obey. The word obey means we are going to listen what you do, you do, and we are going to do it. And what it means obeying? That we are responsible for what we do. Oh, time has gone so fast. But I want to be quickly to chapter 33. Because in this portion, then, Moshe Rabbeinu goes again. He say, by the way, look at what he says here in, we finish chapter 34. Now therefore, go lead the people to the place of which I have spoken to you. Behold, my angel shall go before you. Nevertheless, in the day when I visit for punishment, I will visit punishment upon them for their sins. Okay, God is very clear. You are going to suffer. You are disobedient and you're going to suffer. I always say that it's not God who punishes you. It is you that punish yourself. It's God that doesn't punish us. We punish ourselves. When we are disobedient and we do exactly contrary to what our Creator tells us to do, we are going to suffer the consequences of that disobedience. And we can see it today in many ways. I have mentioned this to you before, and you're going to see how society is being self-destructive by the sins of the people. You know, today we are so open-minded, we are so libertarians, everything is okay. You know, you're okay and I am okay and everybody's okay. Viva la vida. You know, everything is okay. You know, and it's a joke. This is a joke. Because sooner or later, we are going to suffer the consequences of disobedience. You know, we can keep doing wrong. One moment, these wrongdoings is going to catch up on us. And then we're going to say, oh God, why did you you allow this to your people? Why you are doing this to us? What have we done to you? What have we done to you? You know, my faith will fall down. Of only a chain. And then the Lord said to Moses, they said, so the Lord plagued the people because of what they did with the calf of Aaron and Mary. They suffered the consequences of their sin. Then the Lord said to Moses, depart and go out from here, you and your people, whom you have brought out of the land of Egypt, to the land of which I swore to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Now, God is telling back what Moses told him, like, what do you think? I don't remember what I promised. Do you think I forgot, no? No, I will give you. And we'll send an angel before you, they send them, and they want to give you, send you to the land of the flow, the milk and honey, and all those good things. And he's going to get rid of all the people that are in the land. How God get rid of the people in the land? You say, hocus pocus, disappear all of you. You know? What he does? He said, Israel, now go and take it. I give it to you. But you need to work on it. Remember this always. As a principle of the Torah. You know, many of us would like to be millionaires in a second. And that sounds very good. But the truth of the matter is, to be a millionaire takes a lot of work. Everything takes a lot of work. To have a good family takes a lot of work. To have a beautiful community takes a lot of work. Participation of all of us. We cannot be selfish. Everything that we want takes a lot of work. And sometimes takes sacrifices. Our Creator is with us. And remember, when we are going through difficult times, our Creator is talking to us. Don't close your ears to Him. Totally the contrary. Open your ears in that moment and ask Him. You will be surprised how He will respond to you immediately. And you will be surprised how He's going to help you to grow and to keep on going. And go up and then, when the people heard the bad news, they mourned, and no one put on his garments, for the Lord has said to Moses, say to the children of Israel, you are a stiff-necked people, and I could come up to you in your midst in one moment and continue you. Now therefore, take off your ornaments, that I may know what to do to you. So the children of Israel stripped themselves of their ornaments by Mount Horeb. Moses took his tent and pitched outside the camp, far from the camp, and called it the Tabernacle of Meeting. And it came to pass that everyone who saw the Lord went out to the Tabernacle of Meeting, which was outside the camp. So it was whenever Moses went out of the tabernacle, shall all the people rose, and each man stood in his tent door and watched Moses until he had gone into the tabernacle. And it came to pass, when Moses entered the tabernacle, that the pillar of cloud descended and stood on the door of the tabernacle, and the Lord talked with Moses. And all the people saw the pillar of cloud standing at the tabernacle door, and all the people rose and worshipped each man in his door. So the Lord spoke to Moses face to face, as a man speak to his friend, and he would return to the camp. But his servant Joshua, the son of Nun, a young man, did not depart from the tabernacle. Then Moses said to the Lord, see, you say to me, bring up the people, but you have not let me know whom you will send with me. Yet you have said, I know you by name, and you have also found grace in my sight. Now, therefore, I pray, if I have found grace in your sight, show me now your way, and I may know you, and that I may find grace in your sight, and consider the nation is your people. What a beautiful interchange with the Creator. And here is a very important, and so much that I would like to share with you from this. And I better stop here because there is much more that I need to deal. But let me end it in this way for this morning. It is about show me your ways. Let me know your ways. No. You see, in the Hebrew language, there are terms like Chochma, Bina, but one term that is very important is Yodea. God has given us Chochma, and He has given us Bina. But a Yodea is something that means the participation of both. In Chochma and in Bina is Bina, understanding. okay? Chokma and Bina is given by our Creator. Look at this. But Yodea is mutual relationship. What it means is our Creator includes you in His presence. And in that moment, He reveals to you, He gives you the understanding, the knowledge, the way to be more creative. But the Judea is the center of all of this, and that's what Moshe Rabbeinu said. You know, I want to have a total relationship with you. Let me know your ways. Because knowing the ways of the Lord, what I am doing, I am identifying with Him. One thing is receiving information, another thing is identifying with Him. I hope that you grasp a little bit, because there's so much more that we can get. This is a beautiful parasha. There's so much. I have no idea. It's crushing a little bit. But you know what? Every year I get more excited when I read these portions. Because I see more and more and more. And it's my prayer that all of us will be blessed. That our understanding, our bina, we increase with the chokhmah that our Creator gives us. Because we have a Yodea, a knowledge, a companionship, an integration with our Creator. A Shabbat Shalom to all of us.